Good morning.
Good morning.
My name is John Coates here in Natick, Massachusetts. This tape is part of the Morse Institute Library's Continuing Veterans Oral History Project. This is May 14th, 2001. And this morning we are pleased to have with us Raymond Furtney, and you use your middle name, we call you Ray, is that correct? Good morning.
Good morning.
What is your current address?
In Braintree, Massachusetts.
Braintree, Mass. And how old are you, Ray?
79.
And your current marital status?
Married.
Do you have children?
Two boys.
Grandchildren?
Five.
Great-grandchildren?
No.
Okay, I thought we were going to win another one there. Where were you born, Ray?
I was born in Los Angeles, California.
Really? And raised out there?
I beg your pardon?
Were you raised out there?
No, we traveled quite a bit because my mother and dad both were internationally known silhouette artists. And so we traveled. We were up in Canada. My father was raised in Canada, and he was before he became a silhouette artist, he was a school teacher. In fact, it was my first school teacher. And then we went back out to California when I was 12 years old, and was out there until I was 15, and then we came back east and we were settled back here where I finished my schooling and so forth.
Would you define for us a silhouette artist? What did they do?
A silhouette artist cuts profiles, silhouettes. My mother used to do full-length work, and she worked under the name of Mady Roberts. She was also queen of the San Francisco World's Fair in 1915, and so she had quite a record behind her. And so we traveled quite a bit throughout the country, and. When they were doing their silhouette work, and they used to do promotions in fairs, in department stores, and many other places, and earned a very good living at it, and especially during the Depression, believe it or not.
So, how long did they do this? Were they doing this up still? Like the 50s or
they did this up. My dad died in 1950, and he was only 60 years old. He had a heart attack. My mother started to do the work again after he died, and she was doing mostly church work and so forth. And then she got in a bad accident. She got hit in the eye with a golf ball outside of a driving range, and she lost practically her whole eyesight. And so although she lived until she was 89 years old. So.
Hanging in our house is a silhouette of my life, my wife, that was done at the Iowa State Fair in about 1951. Is it possible your mother might have done that?
No.
It was a woman who stood by the Ferris wheel
and
just cut this out, and it's a wonderful piece of work.
There's a gentleman by the name of David Alexander out in Long Beach, California, who got in touch with me last fall. He's writing a book on the history of silhouettes, and I think he knows more about my family, on my mother's and father's side, both sides, than I do. He tracked everybody down, and he finally tracked me down, and so and we've been in contact ever since, and he's going to feature my mother and my dad both in that book.
That's wonderful. How did you manage to get schooling other than through your parents?
Well, wherever we were, I went to school, and I didn't start school till I was 7 years old, and never went to kindergarten or anything. That's when my dad taught that up in Canada, and I started school up in Canada when I was seven, and finished school when I was 12 years later, when I was 19.
And where was that?
In Dorchester, Massachusetts.
What year was that?
1941.
1941. You're coming out of high school, is that correct?
Mm-hmm.
In 1941, the United States entered into the war.
In December, right.
Because of Pearl Harbor. Can you remember where you were on that particular day?
I was, when I heard about the attack, I was at a friend's house. And it was on Sunday, of course. And I was a fellow who eventually went into the Army Air Corps and got shot down and was taken prisoner during the war. But I was at his house, and of course, when it came over the radio, well, I tore home. And to see how my folks were doing. And then I made an effort to get in the Air Corps, because my dad, my father, was in the Royal Canadian Air Force during World War I. And so, you know, like father, like son, I wanted to get in the Air Corps. And I didn't pass the physical because of my right eye. They said it was 20/20 minus, and they wouldn't pass me. I took two, I went back twice, and so finally I heard that if you get in the Army, that you could maybe transfer into the Air Corps, not necessarily as a pilot, not realizing that once they got you in the infantry, forget it. They left you there forever.
Oh, yeah. That day you went home, after having heard the news, was it your intention to enlist and go into the services?
Oh, yes, I did.
You were 19 and just out of high school.
Yeah.
No thought of going on to further schooling at that particular time?
No, not at all.
What did your dad say?
I won a small scholarship to Suffolk University Journalism School because we were the only high school, Dorchester High School for Boys, was the only high school in the Boston area that had a journalism course, which I took. And I won a small scholarship to Suffolk University School of Journalism, which I never took up because I went into service.
What did your father say when you said you were going to go into the service? Did he encourage you?
No, he didn't try to discourage me. My mother wasn't extremely happy about it initially, but I had to, of course, get my folks' parents' signature to go in because I was underage. I was under 21. At the time, you had to get a notarized signature. So they both signed off on it.
Okay, and you tried the Air Force, and they said no. So did you try Navy, Marines, Coast Guard?
No. I just joined the Army.
And tell us about where did you go, into Boston?
Went into Boston to sign up, yes, and to take my physical, and which I passed with no problem, and then went to Devens.
Did anybody else go with you from school or any neighbors? Were you on your own?
When I went to join up, you mean?
My dad came in with me. But no guys from school?
No.
Nothing like that?
No.
And they said, great, we'll take you, and that you were called active service.
And I went.
And went to Fort Devens.
Devens.
How quickly was that?
It was within probably a week.
Really?
When I signed up, yeah. And I went went into the service on February 23rd, 1942.
What? Tell us about Fort Devens. This is the middle of the winter.
It was cold up there, and we were issued, of course, heavy gear, overcoats, and everything else. And then after we went through that center up there, people were sent off in various directions, and I was sent to Camp Cross, South Carolina, for basic infantry training.
Did you take any tests or anything at Devens to suggest where you might serve in the Army?
Well, I took the regular IQ test.
Yeah. Was that at Devens?
I think so.
Or Devens was just a processing center to get you?
Yeah, I forget whether that was at Devens or Camp Croft when we got down to Camp Croft.
Are you saying Crawford?
Croft.
Croft.
C-R-O-F-T.
Tell us about that. What was that near?
Camp Croft, South Carolina, was near Spartanburg, South Carolina. That was the nearest town. And it was a basic training camp. And I was very happy. I went in at $21 a month. And in July I think it was July, 1st of July, they increased the pay to $50 a month. And boy, that was really
something. They doubled your money?
Oh, that was unbelievable. And and then I was promoted to corporal.
What did you do at the infantry training? Tell us about that. What kind of weapons were you associated
with?
We
fired M1s, BARs, Browning automatic rifles. Some light machine guns, the air-cooled machine guns, not the heavy, and rifle practice. I mean, scout patrols, just basic infantry tactics. Obstacle course, of course, you know, all the time, going through that, and then. Near the end of the basic training, they evidently saw something in me, so they asked me if they wanted me to go to OCS, Officers Candidate School, down Fort Benning, Georgia.
Did you say a second ago that you were made corporal upon return, finishing this training?
Yes.
Right out of boot camp, then you're a corporal. You must have.
Well, they made me an acting corporal while I was actually during the training, and then in fact I have. My papers there, I have my discharge from corporal to accept a commission. And then I went down to Fort Benning, Georgia.
In OCS training.
OCS training, that's correct. And became, as they used to call it, a 90-day wonder.
So that takes you up to the middle of the summer or into the fall of 42?
Actually, I graduated from, it was a 13-week course, and I graduated October 1st, 1942, from Benning.
And now you're a shaved tail.
Now I'm a shaved tail.
Newly born shaved tail.
Yeah. 20 years old.
Did your family, did you get any leave to go home and see anybody?
Yes, after we got, knew where we were going, we were sent to the, I was one of the people that went to the 7th Motorized Division. That was a motorized division at that time. We had half tracks. We thought we were going to North Africa. But things changed and they took the motorized part out of it, and we became a strict infantry division. But
okay.
After we left Benning.
Ray, hold it a second. A phrase that you used, we've heard all our lives, a 90-day wonder.
Mm-hmm.
What did they teach you to get you ready to lead men in the period of time you were in training there?
Infantry tactics. They spent time with us as far as psychologists and so forth and so on, teaching us how to get along with men, how to handle problems. But outside of that, they taught us all infantry tactics, what to do they'd throw different emergencies at us, and we had to solve these problems. It was a real tough course. It was not an easy course.
If guys didn't make it as you did, why didn't they? Why were they washed out?
Some were washed out because they just didn't pass the tests. You were given tests all the time. You were asked to take a patrol out at night, and in pitch blackness, sometimes with heavy rain, and you were supposed to go to certain points, and you had to get there by compass, and you had to find, and if you didn't, well, you were stuck out there all night. So people washed out for many reasons. Actually, we lost probably 40% of our class.
That's severe, isn't it?
It was a tough course. It really was. And of course, most of the people were young, and some of them actually were washed out because of physical conditions. They just didn't take care of themselves. But most of the people who graduated from that class were probably anywhere from my age, 20, 21, up to maybe 28 to 30. But that would be the high side. I would say most of them were probably in their really early 20s.
In a course like this, do you develop a specialty? For example, did you become a mortar man or?
No, was 1542, which was a unit.
Spec number?
Yeah, infantry unit commander. Yeah. In fact, that's right on my tender I gave you.
Did you make any close friends that lasted, guys that you would be with for any length of time?
Yes, I made a lot of close friends, and unfortunately I lost quite a few of them over there. As I think everybody who was in the infantry did. Coming back, as I say, we lost contact with so many guys. When I came back, of course, I was in the hospital for quite some time. I was in the hospital for pretty close to a year. And because I had my last wound was a pretty severe wound. So I was in both Level General Hospital, which is up in Devens, and then transferred down to Waltham, to the hospital down there. So I lost contact with these people, and many of them also were from different parts of the country. There was a close friend I had out in Washington. I kept close contact with my platoon sergeant, John Salvino, who got hit very badly in the head, and in fact I thought he was dead, and he was out in California, and in fact he would write. In fact, I've got in my bag here. I've got the last card that I received from him and from him personally. His writing is very bad, and then from then on, his sister would write.
Did the Army at this time? You guys are moving very rapidly in your career here. Did they sit you down and prepare you for cultural differences you might face as you went to other countries? If you went to Europe or the South Pacific?
No, because actually, when I joined my outfit over there in 1942, because I had a 10-day leave when we left
in October of 42.
Yeah, I had a 10-day leave, and then we went out. Then we went out to California, and we didn't know where we were going. As I say, we were 7th Motorized Division. Everybody thought we were going to go to Europe, over to North Africa, they had just come off the Mojave Desert from maneuvers when I joined them, but then things change, and an outfit that had been training for the Aleutian invasion, the Attu invasion, was uh, had been training up in Washington in cold weather. They were sent south down in the Guadalcanal and New Guinea area. And they took our motorized equipment away from us, and they started giving us training, landing training, as far as transport, coming down nets, and they sent us on. They gave us. We're transferred up from San Luis Obispo, California, up to Fort Ord, California, and we went to intensive training, amphibious training, and still didn't know where we were going. I didn't know how, and had no idea, and so that was about it. But they didn't give. No, we didn't. I think probably if the people who went over in Europe, in different countries over there, they might have been given them that kind of training.
Okay, you just mentioned the Aleutians. The Aleutians were invaded by the Japanese in June of 42.
That's correct.
Did you feel at this time that you guys are going to go up and try and get those islands back?
I had no idea.
You had no idea?
Had no idea.
What were you doing up in Washington then?
No, we weren't up in Washington.
Oh, I'm sorry.
I said the outfit that was being trained to go to the Aleutians, where it was up in, was trained up in Washington. It wasn't our outfit. It was another division. And they were sent, for some reason or other, they were taken off that and they were sent south. And then we went, then they started training us for it. But we didn't know where we were going. We had no idea.
And where were you physically at this particular time?
We were at Fort Ord, California.
Fort Ord.
Yep.
And were you continuing in your infantry training, that kind of thing?
Yeah, amphibious. They say we started doing amphibious training. Landing. They took us down one time, and we made a landing at Coronado outside of San Diego. And right outside the Coronado Beach Hotel, which was a naval officer's rest area, we had quite a time on that one. But and we were using Higgins boats. We didn't have any Amtraks then or anything like that. And so we were jumping out of Higgins boats, which is actually what we used on the Aleutians. So it wasn't until later that we got into Amtraks and so forth.
Okay, then where did you go after you invaded North Island and the officers' club down there?
Well, we just came back. Well, we came back to. We spent the night on the beach down there, and then we came back to Fort Ord and continued our training. And then in April of
43 now.
Of 43, we went up to San Francisco, and then from there we were loaded on transports and headed up to the Bering Sea.
This time you knew specifically where you were
once
going.
Once we got aboard ship, yes.
Okay.
We did not know until we got aboard ship.
Tell us about sailing out of there and on being on ships.
Well, we were excited. We didn't know what to expect. We were young. I had a platoon. I was a platoon leader. The oldest guy in the platoon was my platoon sergeant, and he was a regular Army man, and because that was a 7th Motorized Division, or 7th Division was a regular Army division, and he was a career Army guy, and he got killed the first day on Atta. And
well, wait a minute, back up a second here. But
all the others, I was going to say, all the other, my platoon, very young guys. I mean, they I was not the youngest person, even though I was 21, but I had people on there 18 years old, 18, 19 years old.
Did you sail directly to Attu?
No, we stopped at Cold Harbor first. And
where is that?
That's in Alaska. And in fact, the Japanese had bombed there at one point. I guess the year before. And no, we then from there we went directly.
Okay, then you went ashore at Attu.
Yeah.
What about your equipment? I think I've read that more guys suffered from.
Yes, and I was one of them, because actually they did not give us the proper equipment at all. They should have given us shoe packs, which is the rubber bottom soles. They gave us leather boots, and we were told on board ship to saddle soap them and try to waterproof them and so forth and so on, which we did religiously. Believe me, it didn't do a bit of good, because that tundra up there was absolutely the wettest thing I've ever seen in my life. I mean, you'd dig a foxhole and it would fill with water. If you had a sunshiny day, which we didn't get many of, and the tundra got dry, if you sat on it, your rear end would be wet in 30 seconds. The water would just come right up. It was just a wet place. And no trees. I mean, it was the barest thing I ever saw in my life.
So you and others started to be affected by this,
We had what they call, some call it trench foot, some call it immersion foot. But yes, and I got it myself.
Yeah. What about, how cold was it?
It was cold. Some people, if you got in certain areas where there was snow, some people came down with frozen feet, and if they got exposed, laid out there too long. But it was mainly the immersion foot type of situation where your feet were just soaking wet all the time, and you tried to change them, and you tried to wring your socks out and so forth when you had a chance, but we didn't have much chance, frankly.
You meet the enemy the first day?
Yes.
Tell us about that.
Well, we were down in a valley, so-called, and they were up on a ridge, and they just started firing at us. My platoon was, or part of my platoon was, I was asked to go around to try to flank them. And that's when my sergeant, Sergeant Fink, got killed. And he just got caught in a patch of snow, trying to cross a patch of snow, and that was it. You had to stay off the snow. There was patches of snow all over the place. And if you got on it, the Japs would zero in on you. And once they got on you, they never let go. If they had one person out there, they would ignore five other guys, and they'd zero in on that one person. And if he moved, well, that was it. They were on him. They were funny people.
Did you take any other casualties that day?
Yes, three others in my platoon.
And did you finally get the Japanese off this?
We did, not until the next day.
Any possibility of air support?
We had air support, but very little of it because it was so foggy up there, and the air support came off the carriers. And when we finally got down into the harbor that we took, or the Japanese actually retreated from this. Two planes, Navy planes, came in, thought that with Japs were still there, and they came in strafing us. And they went up and around, and we were waving everything at them, flags and everything else, and they came and they did it again. And this time, one of them got shot down. I don't know who did it, but one of our guys did, with a machine gun. So it was a very unfortunate situation, but of course that happens a lot in war.
You say these planes were off carriers. What, you had carriers operating in the area? Or
yes.
How far away?
I don't know how far off they were at all, John.
Do you know which ships they were?
No, I don't. That may be in that deal.
We'll look it up after.
Yeah, I think it is in there.
What was the weather like, basically?
It was cold.
And how did it affect your operation?
Cold and damp. It was a miserable place. I can't describe it. It was mainly all the time we were on there. We probably saw the sun maybe 3 or 4 days.
How long were you there, Ray?
I think the toll by all the mopping up and everything, I think it was probably 3 weeks, somewhere around that. And then from there, when we left that island, when the thing was all over with, we went to Adak Island. And that was the place from where our Air Force was bombing Kiska. So we were stayed there until they sent us into the invasion of Kiska, and of course the Japanese had left. They had gone out, they had taken between 5,000 and 10,000 troops off of there. And
describe that for a second, anticipating another fight, being ferried ashore and empty. What was that like?
We knew what to expect. We weren't happy about it, but we knew what to expect because, of course, after Attu was over and we were still on that island, everybody was hoping, well, we were going to go back to the United States. You know, we'd done our part. We won the war. But that of course, didn't happen. But we were better prepared, we knew. But we didn't make the initial landing on Kiska. Another division did, part of the 10th Mountain Division, in fact, did. I've never read it in any books or anything, but I know what happened. But they sent a patrol out on a ridge because the rumor was out that the Japanese had left Kiska because the Air Force coming back to Adak wasn't getting it started getting less and less anti-aircraft fire. Well, anyway, so we got on there, so we were praying on the boat that they had gone, and all of a sudden, bingo, they said that they were getting fire. And oh boy. What they did, they sent a patrol out. The patrol went out along this ridge. They stopped in a bunker, Japanese bunker. They made some coffee. They left it hot pot on the stove, and they kept going. When they reached their objective, they turned around and came back, and they didn't have the password. Naturally, they hadn't been given it. So they were challenged, and they didn't answer, and they fired at each other. They started shooting at each other. So they finally landed us on the island, and we started getting fire during the night. We got mortar fire and so forth and so on. There were probably 300, at least 300 casualties on Kiska.
And this is all friendly fire?
All friendly fire. There was no Japanese there. They all left. Of course, they left a lot, and then they moved us down to Gertrude Cove, and they had a lot of, they mined every place. And we started using the Japanese blankets and stuff that we found there and everything for shelter. And then all of a sudden the word came down from Kiska Harbor, where the Canadians were, that the bubonic plague had broken out. And they got us off of that island. We had to burn everything. They got us off that island in a day and a half. We were back on transports, and we went on board this Dutch luxury liner, the Tijadani. It used to be a luxury liner, and it was a Dutch Dutch officers and an Australian crew. So the Australians didn't like us at all until they found out we hadn't been to Australia yet.
I get
the
it.
The boys over there were.
Yeah, they were over there.
Yeah. So.
Where did you sail to?
We went to Hawaii.
And from the Aleutians to Hawaii?
Yeah, went to Hawaii. And
that's a good move.
Yes, and then they put us in quarantine because we didn't come directly from the States. They put us in quarantine for a month.
And, whereabouts?
Up near a place near north of Honolulu, up by Waiawa, a place by
Aiea Heights, up in there?
Town by Waiawa. By what?
Aiea Heights.
Yeah, it's up in, actually it was right down below where, right between the mountains and Schofield Barracks.
Mm-hmm.
And it's where the Japanese came over those, the mountains there when they came down.
Through the Paley Pass and up there.
Right.
So you had a good view, but you were stuck in quarantine?
Yes, we were stuck in quarantine for a month. And then I'll never forget when we got out of quarantine. I went into town to make sure I had that picture taken there, one of the pictures I had. And I went in to get, before that, I went into this little barber shop to get a haircut. And there was one chair in there. And I sat down and I says, anybody here? And out from the back came this Japanese woman.
Carrying a razor
Japanese
blade, right?
Woman. And I almost bolted out of there, but I didn't. She cut my hair. I didn't mind the hair cutting until she started shaving the back of my neck. But but it was all right. She gave me a good haircut. So, and then we were there. We went into intense training on Hawaii, jungle training and so forth. And then,
you mean literally the Big Island?
No, we were on Oahu. No, we never got to the Big Island.
Okay.
No. And the only other island we made an amphibious landing on was Maui before we left for the Philippines, but that was later. But then we were there until we left for Kwajalein in February.
At Maui, did you...
Maui, that was later.
Okay.
That was after Kwajalein.
Okay, I thought you
and
had just been there.
An interesting part that people might be interested in. The Marines, and you should know about this, the Marines took a real beating on Tarawa. They came in Higgins boats, and they got hung up on the reef, 100 to 200 yards out. And they came under intense machine gun fire, and they took an awful beating, awful casualties, and they did a lot of brave men went on that thing. I'll tell you, it was a wonder they took the island at all, and it was the island of Baidio, but Tarawa Atoll, and the interesting part about it was that they went in, and they went head on into the pillboxes and the entrenchments that were facing the reef out there, and they went right into it. Well, when they came back, they built a replica of that part of that place on Hawaii, and we went to intensive training on it. And so they decided, instead of going in the way the Marines went in Tarawa, when we hit Kwajalein, we would hit the end of the island. And we went swept down the island endwise, and all of their guns were facing the wrong way.
So you took them in flank.
We took them from the flank, yeah. And our outfit, we didn't hit the main island of Kwajalein. We hit three islands in that group. And the first one we hit was to set up artillery so that they could support the troops going into Kwajalein Island itself. Incidentally, Kwajalein, the Japanese was, that atoll and everything was held by Marines, Japanese Marines. The biggest people you ever saw in your life. I never knew Japanese came that size. And so And they were their top fighters.
Can you date this when you were out at Kwajalein?
That was in February of 44.
And what, are you still in the same outfit?
What's that?
What outfit were you in at that place?
Well, and I was with the 17th then.
17th.
Okay. What happened was, and you know, you forget all this stuff. The 32nd went into Kwajalein itself, and they took an awful beating. They lost an awful lot of officers especially in the second and third battalions. And so when we got back to Hawaii, in fact, right in my bag here, I got a V-mail letter I wrote to my folks and said that I'd been transferred. They transferred 11 of us, 11 officers from the 17th over to the 32nd.
Were you still a second lieutenant?
No, I was a first lieutenant.
First lieutenant, yeah, now you'd been promoted.
Yeah, I got a promotion as a result of that transfer.
Before you went to Kwajalein, did you get replacements and have a full platoon to make up for your losses,
previous losses? Yes.
New equipment, everything else?
Oh, yeah. Plus, I had to send all my uniforms, all my heavy stuff. And you traded all that heavy winter stuff. Yeah, for suntans, yeah.
Yeah.
For suntans and fatigues, yeah. And so, and in fact, I wrote to my folks there, I said, you know, I said, I hated to leave the outfit because, and they gave me a cake. And they had on the cake, it said, Attu Kiska Kwajalein. And then they asked me to make a speech, and I said I didn't know what to say. So then I went into the Company L, the 32nd Infantry, and back to a fellow I was telling you about out in Worcester there that I talked to the other day. He was one of the ones who was transferred also.
And are you continuing to train all the time?
Oh, yes.
Yeah. And where are you now?
We came back to Hawaii, and we were in jungle school, actually, which was very intensive training. When D-Day broke over in Europe on June 6, 1944. So after we came back in around the 1st of March, 44 from Kwajalein, sometime in March, we did continuous training on Hawaii, and then we left, again, we didn't know where we were going to go, but we found out afterwards that we almost hit Iwo Jima. We were scheduled to hit Iwo Jima, and then MacArthur wanted to go into the Philippines, and so we were under the Central Pacific Command under Nimitz, our division and our corps. We were the 7th Division, 24th Corps, 10th Army, and we were under Nimitz. But MacArthur needed help and needed more troops, so Nimitz loaned the 24th Corps, I'm sure it was the whole 10th Army, 24th Corps, at least to MacArthur. And we went in under MacArthur's command when we went into Leyte.
Okay, now you're sailing from Hawaii. Well,
we're sailing from Hawaii.
You're getting on board a troop ship again.
We're on a troop transport, and we went down to New Guinea. Down to Leyte, New Guinea, and we got ashore there for a few hours for a little beer bust, and then the assault troops were put aboard LSTs, and we went into Leyte Gulf, and we were warned about a lot of things. We were warned about Japanese torpedo boats and so forth and so on, which we never saw. We were attacked by some Japanese planes. I don't think they hit anything. And I'm glad they didn't, because our LST was loaded with ammunition, artillery shells, mortar shells, and so forth. And if we'd ever got hit, well, we'd have gone sky high.
You wouldn't be here today.
No. And so, we of course were using Amtrak's in, and so you'd come out of the LST and you'd circle and circle and circle until you got to hit H hour, and then you'd go in. So we landed at Dulag, and the little town of Dulag on Letye. And we had probably the first night when MacArthur was telling everybody he had returned and probably giving people back in the United States the impression that the Philippines were back in our hands, we had about probably 1,000 to 1,500 yards of beach, because the 184th Regiment on our left took very heavy, intense fire, and they had to retreat and go back. And so we'd gone in further, and we had to pull back because our flank was exposed. So we were in foxholes that night with the Battle of Letye Gulf going on behind us, naval battle. We didn't know who was winning. We knew it was a big battle going on. We could see all the flashes and everything else. Our division artillery, which is usually 15 to 20 miles behind the lines, was right back practically off the beach, spitting behind us with their muzzles depressed with grape shot. And we were just waiting for why the Japanese didn't throw a wholehearted attack on us, because it would probably throw us right back into the ocean. And then, of course, if we hadn't won the Battle of Letye Gulf, we'd have been in deep trouble also, because that was the point. We didn't know what was going on.
Were you taking casualties that night?
We took a few casualties the first day coming in. I didn't lose anybody killed. I lost a couple of guys wounded, that's all. We didn't start taking casualties till the second day.
When somebody's firing grape shot over your head...
They didn't actually fire it. They were prepared to fire.
Okay, that means that you're...
We were told to keep down.
The enemy hole. Is not far in front of you.
Oh, no.
And what was your objective as you went ashore?
Our objective was to... We were supposed to have gone in around... the first day, we were supposed to be in probably 10,000, 15,000 yards, and which is quite a little ways in, and we didn't get that far. We were hanging on by our toenails, and as I say, we fully expected the Japanese to pull a counterattack on us.
And they didn't.
And they didn't do it. They didn't do it.
Next morning, what happened?
Next morning, we climbed out of our holes and formed up, and the Japanese had pulled back. And the next people we saw in front of us were Filipinos coming out of God knows where. From then on it was a slugfest. So it wasn't as bad as it wasn't as intense as Okinawa, but it was bad enough, because Letye, of course, had heavy growth, and they had, believe it or not, hedgerows like they had over in Europe. Mm. Not as big hedgerows. They didn't have as deep hedgerows, but there were hedgerows, and you'd get to a hedgerow, and then there would be a big open space, hedgerows on the other side, and they'd go across. They'd be on the other side, and you start across. Well, then you know. Ran into trouble.
Did you have tank support?
Oh yes. Oh yes, we had tank support. And it wasn't until I'm trying to think whether it was near the end of Letye that they finally got telephones in the back of the tanks, and you could come up behind the tank and open this compartment, pull the phone out, and talk to the tank commander. On the inside, and you could direct his fire, which was a pretty good thing.
I understand that 10th Army, at least when they got to Okinawa, was very good at assigning, say, a squad to a particular tank, and they worked as a unit. Was this happening with you guys? Had you been trained to do that?
No, not really, no. The Marines may have done. They didn't do it. We weren't trained that way in our Army. And if the tanks came up, well, we were trained to direct their fire, of course, mm-hmm. and utilize them as much as we possibly could, but we didn't actually have people assigned to a particular tank. And it was interesting.
Where did you go on this particular island? What did you find? How did you finally get out of there?
On Letye?
Yeah.
Letye, we went across the island to the other side, actually. Went up the beach and kept driving the Japanese back. And then at one point, near the end of the battle, we were getting stymied because the Japanese were holding some pretty good positions, and we were up on top of this ridgeline. It was the first time I ever saw an amphibious landing from shore, because they sent in the 77th division, the Statue of Liberty division, and they came into this beach, and we were up there looking at them, and the Japanese were firing on them, and mortars were coming in on them and everything else. And I said, "My goodness, I'm glad I wasn't down there." I'll tell you. So that was it was a strange thing. So, but they did get in, and they flanked them, and they finally broke that line that we had. So.
You guys had enough experience at this time, having gone through Kwajalein and up in the Aleutians, to know that you were up against people who never surrendered.
That's correct.
This called for a point of view in how you attacked and your maneuvering. These guys are not going to give up.
They weren't going to give up.
Was that your experience, that you never took prisoners?
My outfit never took. I never took any prisoners.
And were you taking casualties as you made your way across the island?
Yeah. On a day-to-day basis. They would come and they would try to flank us. You see, there's a lot of, as I say, there's a lot of heavy growth, but there's also a lot of open spaces that we had to cross. And they would get on our flanks and they might charge, or they might just fire at us, whatever. But it was a continuous deal all the time.
Was there a usual pattern that they would come at you at night?
Yes, in some cases, yes. But for the most part, it was mainly in the daylight. Another interesting thing too, we always had passwords, you know, that had a lot of L's in them.
Llewellyn.
Japanese could not pronounce the L's sound, and so if you got the wrong answer, well, you know, you didn't wait. So,
take a second here. Go back to being on an island in the Philippines, and you're what, 22 years old now, 23
yeah,
maybe?
Yeah, 22, yeah.
You're a lieutenant of an infantry platoon.
Mm-hmm.
And it's getting dark, and your guys are digging in or getting ready for the night. You got to go around and look at these people. They're your people.
Oh, yeah.
What do you tell them?
Tell them to make sure that they've dug in properly, and tell them to keep their heads down and keep their eyes open, especially where you tell them. Those people knew at that time. You didn't really have to tell them. These guys were, for the most part, veterans. And we'd always go in a set line with our machine gun set and everything else. We'd usually go in around 5 to 6 o'clock, and on Leyte in the Philippines around 4 or 5 o'clock every day it would rain. Pour. It would come down in buckets for about 15 or 20 minutes. It seemed like it did it every day. I'm sure there was some it didn't, but it seemed like that, and we'd get soaking wet. Soaking wet for the night. And then it would cool off, and it would get chilly at night over there, believe it or not.
Were you guys properly dressed?
Oh, yeah. Yeah. Well, basically, we were in fatigues. That's what we...
They have ponchos?
Oh, yes.
Rain gear?
Yeah, we had ponchos.
Did you ever see Douglas MacArthur?
No. The only time I saw him was back in Boston, Massachusetts, after Truman fired him.
That's interesting that you should wait to see him in Boston.
Yeah, never saw him. And he was a good general in many respects, but he was very egotistical, and he wanted the limelight and so forth and so on. And but of course, the Battle of the Philippine operation went on quite a while after we left. In fact, when we left to go to Okinawa, I mean, they were still fighting up on.
When did you leave Letye?
We left Letye in March of 45.
March of 45, so yeah, you were within a few weeks of Okinawa.
We went by LST up to Okinawa, and we landed on Easter Sunday, April 1st.
Okay, just before we get there, did you guys have time to get your act together again? Did you get replacements?
We got replacements. New gear? We got replacements, and the funny part, I got one replacement. In fact, we were sitting there in the sun, the bright sun, being trained to use that telephone I was telling you about in the back of the tank. Mm-hmm. And I had a replacement, a young guy sitting next to me. He was probably 18 years old. And all of a sudden, I saw a spurt, you know, out of the corner of my eye, you know? And the next thing you know, he's got his handkerchief up to his nose and it's beet red. He had a little something in his nose. He turned out to be, he was a hemophiliac.
In the Army?
And they got him in the Army. Now, I don't, how the heck he ever got in there, I don't know. He was a hemophiliac, and he was sent out, he was sent home, because if he'd ever got a slight wound, he'd have been dead. And I said, he told me he was. And I said, well, didn't you tell anybody? He said, no, nobody asked him. So it was an amazing thing. So, but we got replacements after that was over, and then we came down with various conditions. I came down with, of course, everybody. We tried to keep our people taking malaria, atabrine tablets to prevent. It didn't prevent malaria, but it prevented the onset of it. In other words, it didn't show up on them.
Did all of you turn yellow?
Your eyes would turn yellow mainly, to a degree. But a lot of guys didn't like those atropine tablets, and of course the salt tablets also. You had to keep insisting that the guys take salt tablets. Salt tablets were big pills, and they made you sick. And if you took the pill by itself, I got to the point where the first time I took one, I did get sick, so I chewed them. I chewed the salt tablet, and so it dissolved better in my stomach. And you had to make sure they did all those things. And then I came down just before, a few weeks before we left for Okinawa, I came down with dengue fever, which is they call the bone-breaking ailment. It makes all your bones in your body. So they put me in a hospital tent, and they shoved about five bottles of glucose in me, and big bottles like this. I thought the first one was all gone, I breathed a sigh of relief, and they hung up another one. They kept dripping the stuff in me, and they cured me. I mean, I got over it, and so.
Let's generalize that thought for a minute. You saw your people getting hit. You got seriously ill. Guys around you. We're getting shot whatever.
Well, not at that point.
No, but in the campaign, tell us about the medical care that you guys got. We see MASH on television.
The medical care was excellent, and it's a lot. MASH, of course, was MASH, but
in another war.
Yeah, but the medical care in those forward units was very good, and the medics were good. The medics attached to our outfit were good. I had a medic attached to my platoon. He was an excellent guy. And
did each platoon have a medic?
Yes.
So for about every 70 or so guys, there was a medic?
Yes. Well, the platoon was around, well, anywhere, depending on what you had, was anywhere from 35 to 50 men, depending. Full strength was around 50.
Yeah.
Then another time, speaking of medics, I came down with amoebic dysentery, and the whole place came down with it. This was when we were in a rest area on Letye, before we moved back up to the front lines, and we were in this area, and we were right next to this stream that was coming down from the mountains, and it was beautiful, cold, clear water. It was the most delicious water you'd ever find in your life. And we were drinking it, of course, and everybody was getting sick.
Who was at the top of the stream?
Up the top of the stream, a patrol found a dead Jap up there with his head right in the water. and the water was running over him and coming down, we were drinking the water. And everybody got sick. So speaking of medics, the medics had their work cut out
for them.
They
had their job.
Oh, yeah. No, but they did an excellent job. I couldn't say enough about them.
You spoke a second.
They saved a lot of lives.
You spoke a second ago about being in a rest area. Were you guys ever treated to any kind of a USO show, something like that?
Oh no, no. We were in one rest area on Letye, and we were in one rest area in Okinawa. And he brought us off the front lines, and we were back there for about probably 8 days, and given that we saw some movies, outdoor movies that they had up there, and I remember speaking of MASH. I remember one of the movies I saw was the George Gershwin story with Robert Alda, which was Alan Alda's father. And he played the part of George Gershwin in the George Gershwin story. I remember seeing that. That was probably in May, on Okinawa.
You folks were very busy. You were under fire, and pretty well focused on what you were doing. How did you hear about what else was going on in the Pacific around you, or in Europe for that matter?
In the first place, I'd been getting a lot of letters. My mother was a prodigious letter writer. I mean, I've got, and she kept all my V-mail letters. I've got a whole box full of them. But she would write me sometimes 7 or 8, 10 letters a week. And sometimes I'd get them all at once. And I'd always read the last one first. I figured if everybody was all right, the last letter will the rest of them, because I didn't have time to read them. But they would also send me articles from the Boston Globe and the Post at the time, and so forth. And so I got a lot of news that way.
And she knew what outfit you were in.
When we were on Attu, I had to censor, of course, my platoon's mail. And this one guy wrote, and we weren't supposed to say we were on Attu, okay? Because everybody back home knew we were on Attu. They knew exactly where we were. In fact, the Tokyo Rose came over when we were on the way to Attu and said, greetings to the 7th Division, which is now on the way to the Aleutian Islands. So everybody knew, see, but we weren't supposed to say we were on Attu. So one of my guys wrote his wife And he said, I suppose, he says, you're going down to the beach again this summer. He said, boy, do I envy you. He said, that's where I wish I was at, too.
Very clever.
So I let it go through.
Good for you. Were you the censor for your outfit, or there was somebody higher than you that looking at the mail?
Well, there was somebody higher than me looking at my mail. But
you,
my
you were
outfit,
responsible for your group.
For my group, yeah.
And were you as lenient with other guys as you were with the Attu film?
I didn't use my razor blade very often.
Did you literally
cut the
stuff out?
Unless it was something real, out of line, you know. But
good for you.
Yeah, and the guy who's, and incidentally, the guy who said that, wish I was, that's where I wish I was at too, was one of my sergeants. So, and you know, let's face it, you know, the sergeants run the army, believe it or not. And so you always keep on the good side of your sergeants.
Let's go up to the spring of 1945. Were you guys aware of where you were going when you sailed out of the Philippines?
Soon as we got aboard, not so soon, but the day after we got aboard the LST, they broke out a actual in the wardroom. On the LST, they broke out a mock-up of Okinawa.
Okinawa is 350 miles from Kyushu, so you were going pretty well up into the Japanese front yard then.
Yeah, well, that was a Kyushu island. Yeah.
Okay, and this is island 60 miles long.
Yeah.
You got a mock-up? Were you told where you were going ashore, North Shore?
We got the mock-up of the part we were going in.
And up on the North Shore of?
We landed on the south. We went in and at Kadena Airport, and the 7th Division and the 96th Division, which was the 24th Corps. We turned south, and the Marines turned north. And actually, about 80% of the Japanese were in the south section. That's where they set up their Shuri line and so forth and so on. The Marines ran into opposition going north, but not as much. And when they cleared that up, the Marines up there, the Marines were brought back down south, and over on the Naha area, the Shuri area, and so forth and so on. We were in the Yonaburu area on the other side of the island.
Okay.
The 32nd Infantry cut straight across the island and then turned south. The 96th, they turned south before we did. We went around their flank.
Can you take us back to the Easter Sunday, the first day of April.
Mm-hmm.
Tell us about going ashore.
Well, we heard that the Japanese had built strong defenses in the water, anti-tank defenses and so forth, anti-boat defenses, if you want to call it that, metal piles and so forth and so on. And we saw one sticking up. I saw one sticking up. The Navy's CBs had gone in there underwater and had blown those things. They did a beautiful job. They really did. And the Navy did a beautiful job strafing and supporting our attack, you know, from their carrier planes. The Navy pilots came in very low. They came in right off the deck, and they strafed and so forth. And the interesting part is when we landed at Kadena Airport, we got pinned down by a sugar cane field, because the sugar cane field got caught on fire and the sugar cane started cracking. And it sounded just like Japanese 25s. So help me God, it sounded just, we come off the beach and we hit the ground. We got all pinned down by a sugar cane field. We were a little red-faced. frankly, flabbergasted, but we were also happy that, and the Japanese had pulled right back. We the first day in Okinawa, we received no opposition whatsoever. We got it the second day, but not the first.
My notes say that your outfit put 16,000 guys ashore in the first hour, and you went within 182,000 men in the 10th Army, and under Lieutenant General Simon Buckner.
Mm-hmm.
And on the second day, you start getting really shot at.
Yeah.
Tell us about that, please.
Well, in the first place, the we didn't know this, and we weren't told this. I don't know if they knew it or not. I presume that they hired brass knew it, but the Okinawa was a Japanese proving ground for their artillery. So they had every single hill zeroed in. In other words, they didn't have to fire a few rounds until they got the right spot. If they saw somebody on a hill, they knew exactly where to fire and how far and everything else. They knew the range and everything.
That's how Buckner got killed.
We got a lot of artillery fire on Okinawa, which we'd never received before. We never got any in the Aleutians. We never got any on Kwajalein. And we got very, very little we got some, but very little on the Letye in the Philippines. But on Okinawa, we got hit very bad with artillery. And on top of that, they had these spigot mortars. And these a mortar is a normal mortar shell, goes inside of a tube when you drop it in. The spigot mortar went on top of a spigot, and it was in two parts. It was a big thing. It was filled with heavy explosives. It was mainly an explosive device, not so much shrapnel, although there was some. It was a very thin deal. But they had handles on the side. They put the thing on the spigot, and they'd hook the thing up electronically or somehow. I don't know how they fired it. I never actually saw one that close. And they had a range of about 600 yards, and they never knew where it was going because they had no tail fins on the thing. They'd fire the thing, and the thing would go. They didn't know where it was going. They'd fire in your direction, and that was it. But it was a awful device. And so, but again, we took a lot of artillery on Okinawa, and we weren't prepared for it. It scared the living hell out of us, and you just, you get in your hole and you just hope that one of these things wouldn't. And it took us a while to know when a shell was coming in on you. If you heard it, it was gone. It was gone past you, overhead. If you heard the noise, it was gone. But when they came in on you, you didn't hear it. They were in on you so quick, and so it scared us. And we also on Okinawa, we had these. The Japanese had these tombs on Okinawa, and we just pulled a slab out the tomb, the entrance to the tomb, and we went inside and saw all these jars in there, which was the remains, and we just took them out and heaved them out. we're coming under artillery, we'd get in these tombs. it was strange. And we ran into a lot, and of course, this is what would have happened if we'd had to gone into Japan, because we ran into a lot of situations over there where women were actually fighting, and they were loaded down with grenades and so forth and so on. They'd attack us at night.
Is this the Okinawan women?
Okinawan women, yeah. Yeah. A lot of young women on there.
Ray, statistically, you were up against 100,000 Japanese, and some of their emplacements I've read were 160 feet under the ground.
That's correct.
Their tunnel situation.
They would tunnel from the rear out to the front. That's exactly right.
Can you tell us, I know that you were awarded a Silver Star for your exploits on Okinawa. And you also were hit twice, is that correct?
Three times.
Three times, and you told us earlier that one of these wounds cost you a year in a hospital.
Yeah.
Could you tell us about some of this? What did you do to get a Silver Star?
Well, I got the thing right, got the accommodation right in there. Actually, we were trying to take this hill, and we just couldn't do it. And so my company commander, we tried one day, and we just couldn't do it. So my company commander asked me to go flanking, moving around the side of this hill and come in on it on the flank. So I got my squad leaders together, and we were under this overhang. And this mortar, thank God we were, and this mortar shell came down and hit the top of the overhang, caved part of it in. I lost one of my squad leaders, not dead, but wounded. And I ended up with a small gash in my head, but I ended up with a concussion. I didn't know I had a concussion. So we went and attacked the hill, and we didn't take it. And the next day, well, it says in my citation there that it's still refusing evacuation because we went up again and we took it. And I had five casualties. Two dead.
Has this place got a name, or can you look in a map today and say this is where this particular incident happened? Was this around Shuri Castle?
This was before Shuri. This was the second day, and so we were the. I have a map here of Okinawa, but going through it, I mean, I used to know where everything was. In fact, I marked it up, but there's an actual map of Okinawa.
Thank you. We'll keep these with your records or a copy of it.
And it's all marked up. I'd have to open it all up. And then I probably wouldn't be able to find that particular hill,
Were you treated for your wound, the hit?
My last wound, yes. I got hit once on Letye, twice on Okinawa, and on the last time on Okinawa, I had the company at the time. I'd been promoted to company commander, and because the company commander, my Al Grantham, got seriously wounded, so they made me the company commander. And on the 9th of June, we were down by the escarpment. In the escarpment near the end of the island, and I went up ahead to speak to the battalion S2 or S3 to find out where they wanted my company for the night. And we're on top of this ridge, and he wanted me to put a squad, at least a squad, down on some very low ground, which I objected to strenuously. And the company was coming up behind me. I'd gone ahead in the Jeep with my radio operator. And we were coming off, so I told him we'd have to talk about it later. I was coming down off the ridge, and one of these, I'm pretty sure it was one of those spigot mortars I was telling you about, landed on top of the ridge. In fact, the guy I was talking to, the S, 3, was blown in half, I found out afterwards, completely blown in half. And a piece of that mortar shell caught me in the shoulder here. Broke my collarbone, cracked my scapula, came out right next to my spine, paralyzed my left leg, which I got mostly back, and threw me down the hill with my radio operator, 300 radio operator, and he didn't get hit at all, so I landed down the hill, and I knew I was hitting the shoulder, but I didn't know that it had come out the back also. So when the medics came up, they started working on, they ignored this, and they started working on my back, and I immediately asked for a cigarette. I figured, my lung might be involved. So I took a deep drag of the cigarette, and everything was all right, because we'd do that if somebody was hit bad. We'd give them a cigarette to see if the lung was involved. They coughed it up. If they start coughing, well, we knew there was a problem. So then we were evacuated, and you'll be interested in this, because they evacuated, the mud was so bad that they couldn't get us around the road, so they took us back to the water's edge, and they got us on boats, took us around, and they put, and I landed in a marine hospital, and they cleaned me up in that hospital, and didn't sew me up, I found out afterwards, and I was evacuated to Guam, and I had on the marine top with U.S. Marine Corps on here. So I landed Guam, and instead of sending me to the Army hospital, they shot me to the Naval hospital. They didn't even ask me. It took me 4 days to get out. They wouldn't believe me. It took me 4 days to get out of there.
Did they sail you back to Guam?
They flew me back.
They flew you back.
Flew me back in a DC-3, and I'll never forget. I was ambulatory. My arm was in a sling. But there were people on that plane that were on stretchers. Legs were shot up and everything else. And just before the plane took off, this sergeant stuck his head in the door and he said, "Hey, now remember, you guys, you're going to be flying over water. And if you have to, you have to crash land, you only got 3 minutes to get out of the plane." And these guys in the stretchers started looking at each other, saying, "How are we going to get out of here?"
That's the good news.
Yeah, that was the good news. Yeah. So, and then from there, I after being operated on Guam and put in a cast, I was finally sent back to Hawaii. And from Hawaii, finally back to the States. And then, believe it or not, back to Devens again, back to Lovell General Hospital. And it was a long, drawn-out period, but I was ambulatory. So when I say I was in the hospital, I did have a chance to get out and get home for weekends and so forth, and then I'd have to report back again. But see, I had to take a lot of physiotherapy treatment.
Yeah, was that the end of the war for you, though?
That was the end of the war for me. Yes, that was the end. Well, I think I don't know. I just have a sneaking suspicion that if the war hadn't ended the way it did, and we had to go into Japan, I think I would have probably gone back on active duty. That would have probably been fine. But I did go before a retirement board down in Waltham, and they didn't retire me, but they put me on 50% disability, and took me off and said that I wasn't capable of going back to active duty. But you never know. As I say, they get you down in infantry and they never let you out.
Now, when you first signed up, Ray, I neglected to ask you this. Did you sign up for the duration or a 4-year period, or what were?
No, just just signed up.
Duration plus 6 months, something like that.
I guess so. I mean, it, it's...
That's okay. I'm just asking
because... Yeah, because I've got stuff here. I don't know if it says that or not in here, whether it says duration is... yeah, here's when I was corporal, when they said that was my discharge from that. Discharge certificate there from corporal. Desire to accept a commission, a reason to desire to conduct a commission, but I don't know if it says here. Here I am here. This is certified that Corporal Morton Raymond Furtney has successfully completed the officer candidate course given during the period July 6, 1942 to October 1, 1942.
Now, this would have been on your enlistment papers.
And is eligible for a commission, second lieutenant in the Army of the United States. Because when I came out, of course, when I got discharged down in New Jersey, Fort Dix, New Jersey, I immediately went into the next room and raised my hand again and went into the reserve. So I was in the active reserve.
I'm gonna get to that in a minute. I'd like to ask you to think back to being in combat, particularly in Okinawa, where you suffer very badly, I guess. But before going into the combat, how much did you know about the Japanese and their style of fighting and what you might be facing?
We had been told a lot before we left the States about the fighting on Guadalcanal, what mm-hmm. they went through there, and they that was a vicious campaign the Marines walked into there, believe me. And Marines and Army both were on that. So that campaign had been over before we left the States. That would have happened in 42.
So you'd heard about that?
We heard all about that. We heard also about the, I don't know whether it was a Marine or an Army guy, but they got hold of a Japanese knee mortar. And the knee mortar is about this high, long, and small, has a small shell in it with no fin on it. Sometimes it cartwheels and it comes out of the mortar, but it also has a base plate, and it's a curved base plate. And it's supposed to curve so that they would jam it into the ground and it would hold. Well, this, as they say, Marine or Army guy, I don't know which one it was, we heard about before we left the state, he said knee mortar, he thought it would, so he put it on his knee. He put it on his leg and he dropped a shell in it and broke his leg.
Goodbye.
So that went around. Now, whether it was true or not, I don't know. But it that went all over the place. And so they said, don't put, if you get one, don't put it on your, or fire it from your knee. So I'm trying to recall a lot of stuff, but it's hard after so many years.
I think you've got a remarkable memory. That brings up the next question. Was there, out of all you did in all the time you were in the service, was there the most memorable experience in your career that you think about today?
Getting out, I guess.
Getting out alive, or at least
getting out alive and getting out
more or less in one piece.
Getting out of the service. No, I. There's so many things. I mean, we were worried all the time. We were scared. You got to know who you could depend on and who you couldn't. Everybody was afraid. Everybody was scared. I mean, you know, 9 out of 10 guys were scared and the other guy was a liar. I mean, believe me. I mean, because it was a scary situation. You didn't know what you were going into. And then, of course, you had people before we went on the LST, before we went in Okinawa, one of my guys, came up to me, leaning on the rail, and he came up to me and he said he had a premonition he wasn't going to make this one. And he'd been through all. And he didn't. But he didn't get killed, thank God. He got wounded. But he had a, you know. And then you start thinking, well, gee, how many more times are we going to be doing this? The odds are against me. You know, that's what you start thinking. And it affects your thinking, and then you're worrying about, as I say, my mother saved all the V mail letters that I ever wrote, all the letters that I ever wrote her. She had them in a big box. And I started going through them because I hadn't really done it before. And I went to, after I was knew I was coming out here, to kind of refresh my memory on a bunch of things. And I just, every letter, I tried to keep them from worrying because I was the only child. And my mother had three other boys and lost them all in childbirth. Or right shortly after childbirth, I should say. So I was the only child, only son, and I knew she was very worried. And so every time I wrote, I mean, no matter what I'd been through or knew I was going through, I tried to keep her from worrying. And of course, they did the same to me, I guess, when they wrote me. But a memorable, any particular experience? I mean, when you're through a firefight or something like that, and everything turned out okay, well, you get a little exuberant. You feel good. You feel good when you don't lose anybody, and I think every officer and every non-com, you know, who are responsible for the well-being of their troops are worried, and worried about them, and of course you're worrying about yourself as well. So I can't think of any particular deal. It wasn't all 100% bad. I mean, we had some of our good times. We had some good times in Hawaii. We had we had some lighter moments.
We made
good friends. And I think probably that's the best thing I got really out of the Army. Was the good friends, the good people I met, good brave men, as I say, and quite a few I didn't come back.
For the record, when and where were you discharged?
I was discharged down at Fort Dix, New Jersey.
Okay, and when?
I'm trying to think. October of 46.
And what rank were you at that time?
First lieutenant.
First lieutenant, and could you tell
they
me what
me, they gave me a my bat commander, you know, the battalion commander in Okinawa gave me a when I took over the cub, he gave me a battlefield promotion, but I never got it.
You never got it.
Never got it.
What decorations do you have, Ray?
Beg your pardon?
What decorations do you have?
I have a Silver Star and the Bronze Star. And now I'm being told by the Department of Veterans Services, because the reasons all this came about was that a couple of my grandchildren, they said, "Hey, Grandpa, you've got all these ribbons. You know, I've got the Silver Star Medal and the Bronze Star Medal and the Purple Heart, okay, with the clusters. But they say, you got all these ribbons. You know, what's this ribbon? Asiatic Pacific. Philippine Liberation. Well, where are the medals?" I said, "I never got them." So I wrote in, and they put me on to Karen Lynch. She was the one that recommended I come out here. That's how all this thing started. But she says she's going to get me all these medals.
Good for her.
But on top of that, she found out, or she knew, I guess, that Harry Truman, President of the United States, in 1947, had awarded a Bronze Star to any person who had the combat infantry badge, which of course I had. So Karen told me, she said, you're going to get another Bronze Star. I said, gee, I said, I never heard of that. Well, I told you, I knew this friend of mine, this person writing a silhouette book out in California, and he's drawing the computers. So I'm talking to the phone. I told him about this, so he went into his computer and he found it. And it was absolutely, he found the whole deal and about November of 19, someplace in November of 47 that he awarded it. So I'm going to get that. So, and then of course, as I say, all these other, and of course everybody has a good conduct ribbon.
Most everybody. Can you tell us, when you came home, did you sit down with your family and talk about your experiences?
No.
Where you'd been, what you'd done?
No. Well, they knew where I'd been. I mean, they...
But did they, you ever sit around the kitchen
Nothing was secret
table?
Over there after Attu. I mean, everybody, they knew I was in Kwajalein. They knew I was in the Philippines. In fact, believe it or not, my mother wrote to my battalion chaplain in the Philippines and wanted to know if, because I was the only son, whether he had any influence to get me home.
Oh dear.
And he wrote back and said, I don't think Morton, he said, would appreciate you asking that.
No discussion at home there then.
No, I can't. And my dad, the only thing that he really talked me out of, believe it or not, and he never tried to influence me. After I got to a certain age, he pretty much left me on my own. And as far as making my own decisions are concerned, but when I graduated from OCS, and immediately they know who's going to graduate. Well, down at Benning, they have the parachute group down there. The paratroopers, and they're trying to get people in the officers in the paratroops. So they came up to try to, and they talked. Some of our class went, and so I wrote my dad that I was thinking of going to paratroops, and boy, he wrote me a letter. He said, "Look, you're in a dangerous enough situation as it is." He says, "Don't make it worse." So he didn't recommend that at all. He very strongly did not recommend it. So I took his advice, and so.
When you came home, you went through debriefing, deprocessing, and all of that. And you also talked to people since then about your life in the military. Do you feel that there was any difference in public opinion in the reception you got as to the veterans who served in Korea or Vietnam? Do you think their homecoming was different?
Well, I think the Vietnam veterans got a lousy deal. I don't think they got a fair shake at all from the public. And whether or not you believed in the war, and a lot of people, even some of the people who were over there, didn't believe in the war, even though they fought in it. But the fact remains is whether you believe in the war or not, I mean, these people should have got a much, they should have got their parades and so forth and so on and everything else, like they did after the Gulf War.
Yeah.
You know, those people, they fought an awful war over there in Vietnam. Korea, I don't know. Because Korea, they call it a police action and so forth and so on, but I think it was a lot more popular war, if you want to call a war popular. It was a much more popular war than Vietnam. Vietnam was the least popular war that we ever fought in. So Korea, 7th Division, by the way, was in Korea as well. And that was a tough situation over there. We lost actually more people in combat in Korea than we did in Vietnam, because all those people on the wall down there weren't killed in combat. They were killed during the Vietnam War. They say 57,000, but there was actually, I think it was in the VFW magazine that I got, and they had the actual battle casualties of Vietnam, something under, just under 40,000, something like 38,000, 39,000, not 57, but they were all veterans during that war, and they died during the war. Well, they were put on the wall, and they should be, but I didn't care too much about Korea as far as being unpopular. It was obviously, no matter what you do, some people are going to say we shouldn't be over there, you know, halfway around the world. I mean, fighting somebody else's battles and so forth and so on. But Korea was, World War II, of course, was a popular war, if you want to call it that. Everybody was behind it. People suffered over here as well as people who were in the service. Civilians suffered in a lot of ways, and a lot of people were behind the war effort. Everybody was behind the war effort. Korea was a little different deal, but I don't think it was unpopular. I don't think it was. But Vietnam definitely was.
Ray, we've covered a lot of ground here today. Is there anything I haven't asked you?
I've probably done too much talking.
No. Is there one other thing that when your family looks at this tape, or historians a long time from now, one final thought that you'd like to leave them with?
Well, the final thought is that I hope that we never have to fight another war, and that my grandkids won't have to. I have five, as I said, and three are female, and two are male, and so I hope we never have to do that again. It's not pretty. War is not pretty. It's dirty, and it's not just. The fighting's dirty, the dying's dirty, everything about it's dirty, and nothing fun about it at all, or funny about it. Incidentally, I would like to probably get this on tape, because my oldest son, I have two sons, and they're 14 months apart. My oldest son is 42 years old, and right now he's a lieutenant commander in the Coast Guard, and he'll be getting out this year, 20 years. And he was the operations officer on the Tamaroa, the Coast Guard cutter Tamaroa, which rescued those four Air National Guardsmen during the perfect storm.
Oh, yes.
And he was the operations officer on the ship. In fact, he had the con on the ship during that rescue deal. And I'm quite proud of him. And they did that in 80-foot waves. And let me tell you something. Whatever I went through in World War II, which was ample, but let me tell you, I don't think I'd ever want to go through something like that. That scares me. That really scares me. And I guess I started to tell you before this tape about the time we were going up to Okinawa when we were on the LST and we ran into the storm, and we had these floating docks tied on each side, and the LST was rolling, and every time the floating dock would, which was about 10 feet off the water, would hit the water, the wave would come over the over the LST, and then it would roll the other way, and it would come over the other way. That's how we went up there. We had one full night of that, and a very bad storm. And so when we found out what Chris had gone through on that small 205-foot cutter, believe me, I mean, we're lucky we have him.
Ray, that's a happy note to end on. Thanks very much.
Thank you, John. It's been
appreciate
a real
your
pleasure.
Coming in.
It's a real pleasure.